So Lord Iltari has a subscribe star also known as the Paladin. I would really recommend anyone who's invested in this story to go over and check it out. It's a solid way to help support the author and help get stories like this written. So check out the top link in the description. Though let's start. Will we be me, Paladin, be the Palaparty, Castor, Undri, Julian, Peregrine, and Senkit, conquerors of Heartfire Abbey. Party has been exploring the Abbey and discovered the horrifying truth behind its fall, a deadly plague that swept over the lands and yet lingers upon it, waiting for foolish mortals to enter. To preserve the colonization efforts and retake the summer lands, the party vows to seek the source of the plague and find a cure. However, they have no leads, save one, a secret door in the carven hall underneath the Abbey, which they now stand before. Senkit takes the icon of Pella and returns it to its proper place in the carving. It fits like a glove with a slight click as some unseen mechanism locks it in place. As the party watches, the panel rumbles, ancient gears creak and the huge slab of sandstone steadily descends, revealing a spiral staircase leading down, down into the depths of the Abbey. The party readies itself to march forwards, when Undri spots something glinting in the light and orders them to halt before entering. The elf gets down on a knee and blows the ages of dust away from the entrance, revealing the still shimmering form of a magical glyphin laid in the floor. Julian, you're up. Do you recognize this symbol? She asks him. The Arsimer pulls out his glasses and peers at it. It's definitely a glyph of warding, an interesting version of the spell. See here, it's carven to absorb ambient magic and build up charges so it can activate several times and recharge, he says, pointing at the various sigils around the glyph. Looks like it's made out of either silver or metal, so whatever it is, it's made to last, but I can't tell what the spell is. Why not? Just one you don't recognize? Senkit asks. Well, possibly, but it's also Dwarven runes. I can't read those, so the words carved here make no sense. They didn't seem anything but garbled gook to me either, lad. None of these are normal words, at least ni any are ken. Kazdor says as he examines it, but it is Mitchell, ni silver. Could you translate the characters into common? Julian asks. Aye, but I didn't see how that'll help. The big dragonborn says confused. It won't, but then I can translate from common to celestial to get a better idea of what exactly it is. Julian responds, going to get paper. Can't you just use one of those spells in your book to scan it or something? Undri asks, the clever elf knowing a thing or two about magic. That spell can tell me that it is magical, but that's it. No matter what spell you bind in a glyph like that, the glyph itself interferes and makes it look like abjuration, Julian says as he dips his quill. Where did you learn all this? Peregrine inquires, something I'm starting to wonder too. As I said, my mother was a magi, and I was supposed to be her successor, take up the family business as it were, he says as he works on translating. I've been reading Elminster and Mordenkainen since I was 12, and the only reason I took up the sword is because I don't have the talent for casting, he says. And he sounds slightly bitter about this. Now then, back to the topic at hand, he says as he studies his translation of the rune. He ponders over it for several minutes, checking and comparing with both his own spellbook and another smaller notebook. Well, this could be a problem, he says after a long while of study. What kind of problem, that blow us all halfway to East Windale kind? Senkit asks, arms crossed. No, this isn't an overly destructive spell, in fact it shouldn't prove any trouble for any of you at all, Julian says, assuming of course you were all born on this plane. Dinny waste our time with riddles, laddie, common please, Kazdor grumbles, typical Dwarven distrust of sorcery in his voice, despite his best efforts. It's a banishment spell. It returns things to their own plane of existence, and furthermore, I'm pretty sure it also includes some kind of scan so it doesn't target things from this plane, Julian says. Or in other words, it won't blast you halfway to East Windale, it'll just blast me all the way back to Sigil. This conundrum puzzles the paladins, each one pondering it over in their own way. Kazdor begins to pace restlessly, Undri chews her lower lip and cradles her chin in her hand. Peregrine taps an irregular rhythm on the table, and Senkit bows her head, raising her fist to beneath her nose, tail swishing back and forth. How many can it affect at once? Undri asks. Not sure. Typically it can only blast one target at a time though, but depending on how powerful a spell it is, it might target multiple at once. Julian clarifies, would there be a way to check for that? Possibly. If I was looking at it in a magical spectrum when it was triggered, then I might be able to see how it works and tell you. Alternatively, we could just throw goblins at it until it runs out of juice. Let's not ruin what goodwill we have with them, Peregrine advises. We're going to have trouble enough keeping the peace once the caravan arrives as is. Agreed, we'll go with the detection idea. Senkit second. Julian nods and prepares his ritual, taking out his book and laying open on the table. He sets his glasses on the words of the spell, reaches into his bag, and pulls out a jar of some brown-gray salve. He smears the salve over his glasses and under his eyes and begins to chant. Somewhat unusually for his spells, this one is in common. Iron in the ground, fairy bane and gnome's foe, falcon in the air, down of the keenest eye, charcoal of the fire, refiner and steel's sire, sand of the seas, in torment made clear, focus and reveal, let dance the unseen daughters of Bacob, grant me the eyes of the gods. The Arcanist commands the reagents, by word and will I bind you, by truth and tongue I compel you, by the foundations of the world, and by the three I seal this, grant me sight beyond sight. With a crackle of indigo arcane, the words alight, the salve begins to glow as Julian dons his glasses, the gleaming glass giving him a slightly sinister look, like a mid-scientist or wicked doctor. Quickly now, the spell will not last forever. Peregrine nods and steps forwards, placing one barefoot upon the faintly gleaming metal. In the magical spectrum, Julian can see silver tendrils of divination magic emerge from the brilliant blue of the glyph and wrap around the halfling's foot, seeking and knowing his nature. As I suspected, there is a divination before it activates, he mutters. Now, another person at the same time. He orders, and Undri complies. While she steps on, the silver tendrils do not engage, so it can only scan one person at a time, and doesn't stop scanning as long as they're on the glyph. He smiles. Easily circumvented then, once you know how it works. While the spell lingers, he takes a scan around the place. He is somewhat surprised to see faint and ambient evocation magic in the walls, a faint red that probably explains their heat, as a similar aura surrounds two structures inside Kazdor, presumably his lungs. Undri glimmers faintly indigo, as she is a daughter of the Fae, likewise Senkit, though for very different reasons. Julian looks at Peregrine and is initially shocked to see the creeping black of necromantic magic on him, and then remembers his swords. Strange, those swords actually did have some magic in them, but they seemed just ordinary weapons. What exactly were those bones that made up the hilts? He pondered, but said nothing, knowing he wouldn't get a wholly truthful answer. The party descended into the depths, Undri dutifully keeping a boot on the sigil as Julian passed over to avoid the spell, then following behind him as they walked down the long spiral stair. For someone without the talent to be a mage, you cast well enough, and you're a fine kindler for your own spells and smites. She comments, indicating she doesn't totally believe his reasoning for why he isn't a full-on wizard. Spoken like a novice, Julian retorts dryly. You know just enough about arcane magic to be wrong, Undri. I imagine you have a spell or two in your back pocket as well. The elf nods as they proceed. I also imagine you were taught the difference between a sorcerer and a wizard, correct? He continues. A sorcerer draws upon inherent power, while a wizard learns magic through long study, correct? She asks him. That is partly correct. Study is indeed a great part, but there's more to casting a spell than just learning the words. When I cast a ritual like that one back there, I'm using the words and special catalysts to draw in magic and use it immediately. It's not stored anywhere, and it disperses once it's done. Anyone can do that assuming they know the correct ritual. Julian explains, however, it takes time, while a wizard can invoke the same spell in seconds if they have it prepared. Preparation is the part that takes talent. I don't quite understand. Undri says, still somewhat confused by the distinction. When a wizard prepares a spell, they essentially perform the ritual in everything but the words, binding the magic within themselves and storing it up until the words give it its proper form in a spell. This is what separates a wizard from a ritualist, the ability to store magic inside themselves until they need it. I can't do that, he explains. If I had to guess, it's precisely because I can use my oath's magic. The two sorts probably interfere with one another, and because of my parentage, the divine half is stronger and pushes out the arcane. As they talk, the party with Peregrine in the lead comes to a stop before an old heavy door, which, after some examination, they push open. The musty smell of stale air and dust blows towards them as they enter a place undisturbed for untold centuries. It is not dark here, as indigo light flickers from ever-burning torches on the walls. The floors are cold stone, and before them stretches a long hallway lined with more sealed doors. The party cautiously inches forwards into this eerie place, but when the last of them has stepped through, the old portal slams shut with a loud boom that echoes throughout that silent and forgotten hall. A slight trickle of fear runs down their backs, but they shake it off, for they are the defenders of man, and they shall know no fear. At least, all save Andri, who still feels a deep unease. Underground, in a tight corridor, she grips her swords more tightly and moves to the center of the party, eyes scanning constantly for any potential threat, ears twitching at settling dust, then at nothing in the dead quiet. Her face is paler than usual. "Are you all right, Un?" Peregrine asks her kindly. "Fine, just not fond of being this far underground. We need that deep lassie, maybe 50 feet. This is nee but a wee cellar." Kazdor rumbles, the tall man comfortable despite his rather cramped surroundings. "Un, stay by me. Let's get moving," Senkit advises as she steps forwards, hooves thudding quietly in the emptiness. She heads to the nearest door and looks over it. Atop it is a plaque that reads, "Tame, Hero of Heartfire, may the wild spirit ever be free." She looks at it for a moment and nods silently, before walking to the next over. "Joseph, Hero of Heartfire, may your legacy forever ring proudly across these lands." "So, this is a crypt for the most honored people of the Abbey's history," she nods, confirming her suspicions. "We're on the right track." Julian unsheathes his sword, remembering all too well what happened last time they wandered into a place full of dead people. "Stay your blade, Conqueror," Senkit bads him. "These are the honored dead, hidden away exactly so that their bodies could not be defiled by the touch of necromancy. The dead here are at peace." "I wish that were the case, Heir of Flame." A voice comes from behind her, as a flaming spirit rises from behind her. It is the Tiefling from her dreams, a proud figure clad in burnished plate, with an empty scabbard at his side. "But we have not been at peace for almost 200 years, we?" Peregrine asks uneasily, and is answered as dozens of spirits step from their tombs, a wild-looking northern elf from the one named Tame, a dragon born in artisan's clothing from Joseph's. Down the hall, dozens of ghosts, men and elves, dwarves and halflings, fewer gnomes, one other Tiefling, even an orc. Yes, an orc, not a half-orc, a full-blooded orc with red hands stand before them. It is a small army of slightly angry-looking flaming dead people. "Stay my blade," she says. "There are no undead here," she says. Julian grumbles as he takes a step back towards the door. "Hold, Pridigal," the leading spirit commands with a raised hand. "We mean you no harm." Julian's face becomes a twisted snarl at being called Pridigal, but he controls himself and lowers his blade, though he does not sheathe it. "All right then, ye blazing bastards, what exactly is this all about?" Kazdor rumbles impatiently, intensely suspicious. "Come and follow me, and I will show you." The lead spirit compels, and begins to walk down the hallway. Reluctantly, the paladins follow. The ghost leads them down the hall to beneath the center of the abbey, where a great brazier of gold rests, burning eternally with a red flame not unlike the one Kazdor produces. "Gather near to the brazier," he bids them, and they do so. As soon as they are assembled, the floor beneath them begins to rise, carrying the party, the ghost, and the brazier all up, up and up into the tall dark. "Hang on a wee moment there, this shouldn't be possible," Kazdor points out. "If there was a bloody great hole under the abbey like this, the main tower would collapse into itself. Arcane sandstone's relatively light, but come on now. Not to mention we've already risen taller than the surface," Julian says. The others all give him a bewildered look, wondering how he can tell. "I fly, you get a sense for how high up you are when you've been doing that for a while." Soon though, the ascent begins to slow, and then stop altogether as the pillar finally comes to a halt in the center of the bell tower. From here, the paladins can see far out across the land, and know that this is not the land they entered the tomb from. They all recognize it though, for it is the landscape out of their nightmares. The sky is completely black, neither star nor moon fills it, nor do clouds obscure them. Clouds would reflect light, such as from the dancing phantom flames that ring the wall of this weird copy of the Abbey, but the light does not have any clouds to reach, only a hungry void that stretches on forever. Around them lies the strangled echo of the forest, and from this great height they can even see the river, which now glows sickly green and is choked with the dead. Maybe throwing all the corpses they created into said river was a bit of a bad idea. All this though they have seen before, the black vines and the dark world, the sight alone no longer horrifies them as it once did, that falls to every other sense. This world is deathly cold, a chill that seeps into the bones and soul. The party huddles close to the fire and Castor, but even he is chattering. It is quiet, silent as a tomb, no wind sounds though it blows all about them at this great height. The air is foul with the heavy must of grave dirt and the disgusting stench of rotting foliage. The air even tastes wrong, granting no reprieve if they breath through their mouths. What in the nine hells is this place? Castor chatters, and both Peregrine and Julian answer. My people call it the Shadowlands. It's supposed to be the world made out of Fearon's shadow, orbiting us opposite the sun, but not in quite the same place as the moon. Peregrine says, I never imagined I'd get here, not that I wanted to anyways. Shadowfell actually, and while I disagree about where it is, you're basically correct about what it is. Julian corrects him. Among other things, the material plane orbits the sun. Everybody looks at him like he's crazy, and he sighs, somewhat used to that look. You need more Copernicus and less Tolkien, he grumbles scholastically. All right, you spectral schooner. Explain yourself and why ye've been stuffing me and me mate says with dreams about this place. Castor demands of the spirit. This is indeed the realm of the dead and undying, and I have brought you here because you seek to cleanse my homelands of the curse I failed to stop. The spirit says, unconcerned by the dragonborn. He is more solid now, still burning brightly, but from within and not without. If they had a desire to try, they could reach out and touch him. The plague. Andre guesses. And the spirit nods. Once this place was of the utmost bounty and wonder, for the walls between my home and fairy were weak, the summers were long and the harvests magnificent, a place as close to earthly paradise as could be. Since ages long before my time, this abbey stood as the beacon of the southern fair lands, as we called them then. Countless wicked creatures strive to conquer it, but the blessings of the gods were with us. The elves and dwarves of Fi Charon and Mighty Drake in Feastin, Dragon Mountain Fortress, or Volcano Fortress were our friends. Greatest of all our gifts was the mighty sword Alantic Malshaded, said to have been granted from Bahamut himself, he says, and Castor twitches slightly at the mention of the Dragon God. All was well, for a while at least, and then Mort and Kanan. He snarls the last word with enough anger to make a bloodthirster blush. In the name of his beloved Balance, he sought to right the balance between life and death, so he drew upon the power of Vantalife, from the deepest black, and withered the wall between the worlds, letting the wicked energies of this place bleed into the living world. The plague. Andri says once more with grim understanding. Not immediately, for a little while we were safe, for the power of the gods and their artifacts protected us, but evil attracts evil, and a greater horror than any other came upon us, and worse yet, an ancient worm set upon Draken Feastin, and the Lit and the Dwarven kings fell. Drow rose from beneath Fi Charon, and the elves fled into the Fi Wild, leaving nothing but ruins covered in spider webs. The abbey stood alone, and eventually, we fell. So here I am damned to ever watch from this tower where I fell, cutting down the great bell to plunge myself and the leader of that horde into night everlasting. In later days the crawling dark set its tendrils into the land, and there was a blight upon it. The wizard's precious balance was preserved, for sickness was in the bounty of the land, such that any who eat of it shall be struck down by plague. So is there no cure? Senkit asks as the spirit ends his sorry tale. No. You cannot cure the stuff of death. While this curse remains, the Summerlands shall remain a hunted trap, save for the few consecrated places left, such as this abbey, for here we keep watch, and the dark shall not stand against it, although the spawn of that terrible spell itself has come against us. For even in death we serve, bound in fire and flame, our purpose and might are one. Senkit raises an eyebrow, recognizing the words. You serve the Order of the Blazing Sword, she notes. That explains why I was the first one to see you. The spirit nods. So, how do we break the curse? She asks. You don't, Julian says flatly. Why not? We just track down the spellcaster and kill him, Senkit says with a shrug, and this time it is Julian's turn to look flabbergasted. One does not simply track down and kill the greatest midge since fucking Vnka. He explodes. This maniac rips apart the walls between worlds for shits and giggles. Even if we could kill him, assuming we managed to somehow get a solar or two on our side, there's still the problem that he turned the barrier into Swiss cheese, he explains. And Senkit realizes that apparently this Mordenkainer was somewhat of a big deal out here in the West, taken aback by the Arcanist's sheer incredulity. Calm yourself, Julian, Peregrine cautions. Besides, that's not the solution, is it? You said the plague was gone when the power of the gods was strong here and their relics were in the right places, didn't you? He questions the spirit. Indeed, restore the holy places and take back that which was lost, and the gods shall surely protect the lands once more. Julian seems almost as skeptical of this plan as the initial idea of hunting down Mordenkainen. But when he remembers that's an option and more likely to get him killed than throwing himself off this tower, he keeps his mouth shut. Well, then I suggest we get to it, Andri says. This will not be an easy endeavor, probably not, but we'll succeed, Peregrine says hopefully. What makes ye so certain, wee laddie? Kazdor questions as the pillar begins to descend. Simple, really, the ever-cheery Huffing says as he pulls out his pipe. We're crusaders, we'll succeed because the gods will it. Be me, Paladin, be Kazdor the Avenger, Julian the Conqueror, Andri the Ancient, Peregrine the Redeemer, and Senkit the Devoted, the Pala Party, with the origin of the plague that wiped out the previous civilization in the Summerlands revealed. The party prepares itself to set out into the unknown to restore the places of the gods and drive evil from the lands. Kazdor works tirelessly in the forge, repairing the armor of the dead legate and adjusting it to fit Julian. The Arsimer initially protests, saying the armor should be Kaz's, but the Dragonborn just chuckles, laddie. If I were to try to put this on even with modifications, it'd be less covering than my own armor. Julian scours the tomes of the Abbey Recorders, trying to trace where the locations of various important sites are, but with no surviving map, it's largely guesswork. As far as he can tell, the old Dwarven fortress is far to the west by the sea, Fi Caron is somewhere in the northeast, and the halflings seem to have lived around the great lake from which the main river flows. There is no clue though as to where the legendary sword might have vanished to though. While Julian tries to construct a large-scale map, Andri scouts and maps the surrounding woods, charting everything within a half-day's ride of the abbey. In between mapping, she busies herself with her Fletcher's tools to replenish her stock of ammunition. Senkit takes over the broad-scale administration of the abbey, directing jobs for each of the goblins and halflings according to their skills, discriminating between neither and taking no laziness from either. Somewhat amusingly, her determination to make them work actually starts to bring the two races into a sort of camaraderie as they collaborate to get out of chores and acquire more food. Much to the de facto abbess's chagrin, Peregrine on the other hand is primarily dedicated to the spiritual health of their new charges, devoting much of his time to teaching the halflings about their pantheon. However, he is somewhat stumped by how to teach the goblins, and he confides in Eort. There's just the problem of finding a god for them. The halfling sighs, his normally cheery demeanor troubled by his theological problem, considering most of their original pantheon no longer exists, and the one fellow left is just going to get them right back into trouble. How are you handling this? I'm probably the wrong person to ask, my friend, Eort says somewhat apologetically. Believe it or not, I never stopped paying McGulb yet. I hated Cluny for entirely secular reasons. Peregrine is rather surprised to learn this, and it shows. Eort sees this and explains, I'm not particularly religious, but I keep an eye on my creator. I still believe in the order and discipline he stands for. It's what keeps my people together and makes us more than just another race of bandits and barbarians like the orcs. I won't discount the good he's done for my people. If you want a god you can get the goblins to bind to, try Nilbog. Nilbog, isn't that just a title for the jesters? Not exactly. They've got that title for him. He was essentially the joker god, not particularly powerful but able to use what small power he did have to confound and befuddle his enemies to defeat them. Technically speaking, he's in pieces, but the jesters still have some of his power. Maybe you could spin him as some form of Robin Hood figure, using cleverness and guile to defeat oppressors and protect the weak. I think that's the idea behind more than a few of your own gods, HM. I guess I could probably spin some of the old stories with his name on it. A story must change to teach the lesson best after all. Thank you for the advice. Anytime, Peregrine. And so Peregrine begins to teach the goblins about Nilbog, the shattered jester god, who defeats tyrannies with a joke and a laugh and a clever plan. All the while he silently prays that the goblins and halflings don't compare notes and realize he's telling more or less the same tales. While he's not teaching, the small knight begins to record the stories in a large book for the halflings and goblins to use to learn from while he's out adventuring. After almost a week at the abbey, the caravan finally arrives. It's not looking too badly worse for wear, but it is most certainly smaller than when it first arrived. The blight has struck quite a few, but after realizing the source they've been subsisting off their existing supplies, now that they have reached the abbey, they'll be able to replenish from the surrounding area with far less risk than before. However, it is only a matter of time before the area near the abbey is no longer able to supply the caravan. If the blight is not driven back relatively soon, food will most certainly become an issue. The paladins assemble on the walls above the main gate. Yort, Joke, and the representative the goblins have chosen, a rather large and intelligent specimen named Skarsnik, alongside them. As the caravan approaches and sees the unusual party composition, they pause and send for the leader, a half-elf named Williams. "Hello there. We got your message. This is really quite the place you've found," he says cheerfully, actively trying to avoid sounding confused at the presence of more halflings and goblins. "And you've found allies. For us, I trust." The pause wasn't intentional, and his smile is just as cheery as ever, but Williams is just a shade worried. "Indeed we have. This land is beautiful but rather harsh. It's a good thing we found some friends to work with to make sure we all keep our bellies full and our heads on our shoulders, eh?" Peregrine responds, equally cheery. Andri can sense something the others can't in the air. While they're all smiles and no weapons have been drawn, Peregrine and Williams are tense under their relaxed grins, like two participants in a duel. The gates are opened and the caravan enters, Williams and Peregrine walking side by side. "This is a truly impressive structure you've managed to take, Sir Peregrine," Williams compliments the halfling. "It really is. Without the aid of our allies it wouldn't have been possible. We owe them a great deal. I can see, even in a siege we could hold out nearly forever, assuming we don't have too many mouths and not enough to feed them. The hobgoblins must have had the same idea. The larder is very well stocked, the orchards are in bloom, there's a fine coop of hens, and that lake even has fish. Plus, the surrounding area is quite bountiful, if someone who knows them goes looking." The pair enter the main hall, and Williams whistles. "The main building is quite defensible as well. Even if the enemy was inside the walls, we could hold out in here." "Indeed, and there's room enough for all to live here comfortably. The hobgoblins kept the goblins outside though, proved useful for helping win them to our side." "Really? Well, it just goes to show how divisions can be such a crucial weakness even in a strong position. We can't afford to have anything like that with as low as our numbers are." "I know, these new additions are a serious boon to our manpower." "Yes, I suppose that having an additional source of labor will be useful. I've been working to educate them, draw them towards better gods." "Oh, have you now?" "Yes, I found Nilbog to be a good one. He's a clever god. Uses trickery and clever pranks to confound them, generally antagonize any and all oppressive forces over his people." "Is that so?" The other paladins stand at the sidelines as the two continue their smiling duel of implication and counter. Neither one of them can afford to be seen as arguing, but Peregrine's eyes are as hazel sharp as ever. "I hate this." Senkit grumbles in the background. "Will they just say what they mean and argue it out already rather than dancing around it?" "Probably because Williams knows you'd crush him if he said what he really thought," Julian notes. "Are we talking about his thoughts on the goblins or just in general?" she asks him carefully. "Probably the goblins. They're trying to reform, and as much as you rage at the little buggers, you're starting to grow a bit of fondness for them, Abbess," Julian says, the title making Senkit start. "I'm nobody's Abbess," she growls at him. "Do you really see me in white robes standing around peaceably, in my mind's eye?" "Yes, and it's hilarious," Julian admits honestly, taking one step back as Senkit grasps her mace. "That had better be the extent of your mental images," she warns him, but Julian is cool as a cucumber. I've got more important things on my mind, and my father constantly bitching at me telepathically. I don't have room or privacy for anything beyond that, the Asim responds before turning to go. And besides, you're not my type. Wait, your father can do that. Asimov'll have an angel that's supposed to guide them on the right path. My father had enough clout to see to it that he keeps an eye on me personally. I mostly just ignore the bastard though. Strong language for any angel, let alone your own father, if the sandal fits. Julian says, his voice more than a shade bitter. And considering he's been telling me to kill you pretty much since we've met, plus all the other nonsense he's pulled, this one fits like a glove. Julian walks away, leaving Senkit to ponder. By this point Peregrine and Williams have finished their smiling duel and turned to set their other ways, the former sighing as he heads to the cellars. Down in said cellar Castor is busy discussing the various ales, wines, and cordials stored there with several dwarves in their rocky tongue. Peregrine stops at the stairs and listens for a moment, not understanding what's being said but still mildly amused to hear Kaz not sounding accented for once. He slips into the shadows as the dwarves finish their conversation and head upstairs, then slips down to see Kaz. Was wondering when why single quote AD slip out o' the shadows and talk, Kaz says as he pulls out another mug and pours the halfling a drink. How did you know I was here? He asks. Thank you, he adds, sipping his cordial. I've been round ye long enough to get your scent, and the door lets in a wee draft when it's left open. The big dragonborn says as he takes his own drink, and I figured ye need a cup o' something after the yelling with that Skinner. Diplomacy, an exhausting, thankless, but necessary task. The colonists like Williams, I had to get him on side for this to stand any chance. Ye think it's gonna work? I don't know. It's mostly humans and they'll work with anyone if it's to their benefit. The gnomes probably won't care, but there's some dwarves and elves, and well, you know how half of that goes. Aye, but they're glamoring like myself, they've worked with the drake for years and they'll grumble and keep suspicious, but they will need cause trouble after I've made me vouch. So that's what you were talking about. Aye, only at first, had they get a few drinks in them so they'd remember how much they fumed when Mida took me in. Course there was neither could do about it then, and I proved them wrong, even if I did burn down that tavern that one time. That sounds like a story worth hearing. Nee really, single quote AD some bloody good whiskey, but it was me first time with that kind, gave me the hiccups. Combine that with a bunch of flammable liquid in wooden barrels and you've got a wee bit of a problem. Wait, dwarven beer is flammable? Better than most oil laddie, we dinny make the water ye humans and wee folk drink. Apparently you're not the only dwarf who can breathe fire. Peregrine joked, then turned to slightly more serious matters. How are the preparations for our next expedition? Julian has his armor and I've got me supplies ready and the guard's equipment reinforced. Ah, I'm ready when ye are. Right then. I'll speak with the others, but I believe we should leave tomorrow at dawn. So quickly. I want to stay, don't get me wrong, but if we stay we'll get caught up in more politics when we should be moving north. A fair piece of advice, laddie. Kazdor agrees. I'll face a dragger, a lick, a groby horde, but knee bold enough for politics. Peregrine laughs, and when he sees his friend's deadly serious expression he laughs all the harder until Kazdor picks the chuckling halfling off the floor and carries him upstairs. After meeting with the others, the party agrees to set out before becoming embroiled in petty politics and disputes, and before Undri, Senkit, and Julian respond to the petty politics with overwhelming blunt force trauma, poison, mind control, or other such nastiness. And so that night a great feast is held to welcome the colonists and send off the heroes. Peregrine specifically sets out seating arrangements such that all three major groups, colonists, goblins, and halflings, are sat near members of other groups. At the high table, the paladins take their seats alongside Joke, Skarsnik, and Williams. The food is served, and is both bountiful and delicious, roasted salmon, venison stews with many herbs, mushroom salads, salads, freshly conjured bread, whole rabbits and rotisseries, boiled eggs, and far more. Human, elven, halfling, and even goblin food, not delicacies, but still fine hearty food. To wash it down comes human mead and dwarven ale, elvish wine and halfling cordial. Some brave souls even try the goblin's mushroom beer, which is earthy and fortifying, and while it won't get you drunk, It will give an interesting experience since you are drinking shrooms. Kazdor and Undri trade drinks again, before Senkit challenges the Dragonborn to a drinking contest. The Dwarven contingent and several others watch and cheer as the two down tankard upon tankard of ale. Kaz is more experienced and has more body mass, but Senkit is holding on through sheer bloody-minded determination. She is simply too stubborn to get drunk. After the two put away two casks, Peregrine intervenes and calls a draw before they deplete the entire stock. As the party starts to come to a close, the desserts are served. Toasted bread with cinnamon and sugar, chilled pies and a warm nut cake. To Yort's delight, Peregrine managed to find a recipe for candied chestnuts. The hobgoblin grins ear to ear and grabs his staff. "What's that for?" Undri asks. "I hollowed it out after last time," Yort responds as he begins to fill his pockets, his bags, his staff, and his mouth with the nuts. If it weren't for the fact that earwax tastes awful, he'd probably have tried to fit a couple in his ears as well. That would have been to his detriment though, as while the happy crowd is sitting there digesting, Williams steps up and pulls out a lyre. As the hall rests, the half-elf sings, and there is magic in his voice. The song is an old one, of the romance between the human Beren and the elf maid Tinavil. The illusion of a winding wood paints the walls as the bard sings the ancient love song with the passion only an echo of that song can bring. The night carries on as he finishes one song and flows smoothly into the next, of the tale of a great war and the heroes who won it, of the chariot that flew into the heavens and then returned to slay a great dragon in a single charge, and on the songs flow until the various groups start to wander off to bed. "You know, I still don't trust that spoony half-human," Undri yawns as she wanders back to her room. "But he can sing as well as any elf," she admits grudgingly. Kazdor and Senkit stumble off to their part of the barracks, and soon drunken arguing can be heard as they cannot apparently recall whose bed is whose. The party tunes out the noise and drifts off. In the morning, Julian, Yort, Undri, and Peregrine awake, slightly hungover, and get ready to go. When they are prepared, they note the lack of their crimson companions and wander over to their dormitory. Senkit and Kazdor are still out cold on the floor in the pile. It appears that they stayed up arguing with each other until they fell asleep on top of each other. They did have enough sense left to at least remove their armor though, and each piece is very conspicuously in its own pile. "Bloody hell," Julian sighs. "I'm not sure if this is stubbornness and possible hoarding behavior or just drunken stupidity." After being roused by judicious Julianic application of a bucket of cold water, the two chase him from the room and get dressed, each applying a lesser restoration to remove the rather severe hangover. "You are never allowed to have a drinking contest again," Julian grumbles as he removes one of Kazdor's socks from his head and hands it back to the Dragonborn. With that small bit of silliness resolved, the party once more mounts up, even Yort. "Wait a wee moment there, laddie, ye can summon a mount already?" Kazdor asks. "No, but I can buy one. We do have a rather large chest full of gold, remember?" Yort responds as he calls for the pack mule to come up, the chest on its back. "I'm bringing that. It might just come in handy." "Fine, but if you manage to attract a dragon, you get to fight it," Senkit warns him. "So when's the match between you and Kaz?" Julian chuckles at her. "Or was that last night?" Senkit gives him a look that says that she will send him back to Sigil via force of mace to the face, and he just laughs and spurs his horse off. The fuming tiefling races after him on her Iguanodon as the party sighs and heads off in pursuit. It is in a somewhat unceremonious manner, and probably not one befitting a bunch of holy warriors, but the paladins are on the road once more, chasing each other off into destiny. "Be me, be not me, be the paladins, Yort the betrayer, Julian the conqueror, Kazdor the avenger, Peregrine the redeemer, Senkit the devoted, and Undri the ancient." In their quest to drive the blight from the summer lands, the party has set out northwards, to the ruined former capital of Zanjonas, hoping to find the location of the other major settlements there. Unbeknownst to the rest of the party, Julian has his own agenda for seeking the ancient city, as his visions have called him to seek someone or something there. The party rides north, stopping briefly by their reclaimed chapel to pray for protection. While the party reinvokes their devotion to their gods, Julian the Godless opens his spellbook. Several days ago, a new page, written in Celestial, appeared in the old book, neither a spell of his own making or one that his mother wrote into this. It is a spell to call forth a familiar to serve the summoner, or so it appears. With the newly acquired free time, Julian lifts his hand over the page, lays out the reagents in the correct pattern, and begins to chant. The swirling indigo light of all arcane magic begins to glow around him as his words build, and the words on the page glow, not with arcane power though, but a burning gold. The celestial spell continues, fire licking across the page and swirling together into a coherent form. Here Julian applies his mind, shaping it into his desired companion. For a moment, the arcanist pauses, wondering perhaps what to summon, and then a slightly sad smile crosses his face, and he calls on an old friend. When the paladins leave, they are somewhat surprised to see a cat purring around Julian's legs as he reaches down and pets it. Found a stray? Andri asks as she smiles at the cat. Not exactly. This is Bast. She was my mother's familiar once upon a time. I recently discovered the spell to call her back, Julian explains. A frown briefly flickers across Andri's face, and she and Julian share a quick look. You found spells in the abbey? She asks, but that's not what she's thinking. We found a portal into the Shadowfell and a small army of angry flaming ghosts. A few spells wouldn't be the most ridiculous thing in that place. He responds as he dismisses the familiar for transport. Now let's get going, we're burning daylight and it's at least a week to the city if Yort's intel is correct. Andri gives him a look that says they'll talk later, but says nothing. The paladins mount up and ride out again. By sunset, they reach the bridge where they first met Yort, where the river and the road meet. How is the foot, by the way? Peregrine asks the hobgoblin, who winces at the memory. Healed, unlike my ego after that particular bit of incompetence. Yort grumbles, turning faintly blue from embarrassment. Let's not mention that again, please. The halfling smiles good-naturedly and pulls on his hat before he gets to work on cooking dinner. Andri scouts the area around the camp and doesn't find anything out of the ordinary. There are bear tracks in the woods, but nothing unnatural or monstrous. Ah, would ne mind having a bear for dinner? Kazdor admits as he tends to the fire. It would probably have better manners. Senkit ribs him with a smile. Ah, meant as a steak. The big dragonborn rumbles, or maybe that was just his stomach. Big beastie and lots of fat and muscle. He says, licking his non-existent lips with a forked tongue. Bear, really? Senkit says, having not really considered it as a potential food source. You eat dinosaurs, Sen. You're in no position to judge. Andri reminds, unless one of you feels like going and getting that bear, you're getting shrimp. Peregrine says as he returns with a net filled with the small crustaceans, or we could have bacon. He jokes, looking at Kazdor's boar snoozing by the fire. Warpig opens one eye with an unamused glare and snorts once. The ornery beast looks as though it might want to trample the small chef, but it's nice and warm on this patch of grass, so he isn't moving. I'm still mildly amazed that you managed to get that thing to do what you want. Yort confides to Kazdor, and the dragonborn chuckles. So am I, laddie. Spirits are high this night as the party eats. It is good to be on the road again, headed for their next mission. The food is good, the stars are bright, and the moon is high in the heavens. The friends eat and are merry. You know, I've still been working on this whole name thing. Peregrine says as he polishes off a slice of bread. And I'm still stumped. Every good idea I have is either already taken or too close to something that's already been taken, or it doesn't do a good job saying what we're all about. What about the summer nights? Base it off of where we are? Andri suggests. That sounds like the name of a bad romance novel. Kazdor protests. And I'm fairly certain that's a title for some fairy prince or another. Probably best to avoid that unless we feel like having to deal with an angry Sead. Julian concurs as he summons more bread. We're somewhat jumping the crossbow here. Senkit cautions. We have to actually survive and win long enough to get a legend. We'll be fine. The gods will our victory. Peregrine says confidently, from almost anyone else that would have come off as supremely arrogant. But for Peregrine it is a simple statement of faith. I suppose that could be a name. The gods will. Eeyore suggests. Gods or no, we'll still win. Julian says. And which god would it be anyways? Something tells me that considering we've got five entirely different pantheons here, they're probably too busy fighting over who gets credit for what we do. Fair point, Jules. Peregrine laughs. It's honestly a small miracle, pun intended, that we haven't all started tearing one another apart. I mean, really, look at us. We're a who's who of rivals in all the classic stories, aside from maybe tossing in a gnome and the kobold. No miracles needed. Julian smiles, because it's not the gods, or a lack of them, that we're fighting for, not really. We're all out here risking our lives to make things better, to beat back the chaos and defend those who can't defend themselves. Sure, we all do it differently, and we'd all probably call it something else, but we're fighting for something fundamental. We're fighting for justice, peace, goodness, and the right order of things, and we aren't letting our different approaches divide us. Nice little speech there, Hawk Boy. Are you saying we should be some kind of Justice League? Senkit prods him, but it's not serious. She appreciates him putting it into words. Nee, that's cornier than Summer Nights. Kazdor rumbles, and didn't he say Peace Force, because that's even worse. Well, that leaves goodness and order. And considering our occasional habit of slaughtering anyone and everyone that gets in our way, I think using goodness will be just a shade hypocritical, Peregrine says, and the others stare at him. Yes, I know they're mostly all evil, but still. Order then, and we won't let our disagreements divide us, Julian says. Order undivided it is then. I like it, Snappy, and gets the point across. Senkit agrees, the others also agree. Kazdor is satisfied that it doesn't sound ridiculous. Peregrine thinks it will make for a good story. Andri states that she's probably thinking a different kind of order but accepts it. Yort still slightly prefers Deusvalt, but he goes along with it. That night, the party beds down in their tents and the usual watches are set. At the turning of Andri and Julian's watch, the elf stops him. About that cat, what about her? Julian asks, somewhat confused. I may not know much about magic, but even I know a familiar can't be in two places at once, and I highly doubt your mother dismissed her. You'd be correct on both fronts. If you suspect my mother is dead, then you are correct on a third front, Julian answers, his face becoming a cold mask. She perished 5 years ago, shortly before I left Sigil for this plane. I'm sorry, Julian. Andri tells him, genuinely sympathetic, don't be. It was a long time ago. 5 years is not a long time, and losing a parent is never easy. You speak from experience, don't you? Andri nods sadly. I didn't mean to dredge up bad memories, I just wanted to let me know that you were here for me. I understand, but I think you don't understand. Tell me, how long ago have you been walking in the human world? Not long, only 20 years. Julian smiles in spite of himself. See, that's what you aren't getting, for humans, and well, I'm essentially a human in terms of my lifespan. 20 years is a long time. 5 years is a long time. We grow old and die too quickly, and so we learn to live with it. That is true. You do have faster hearts. And faster ones to heal. I'm fine. Andri smiles at him. You're a terrible liar, Julian. The Arsima crosses his arms. You've got the magic it would take to force me to tell the truth if you insist on believing that. I do, but I won't use it. She says as she turns, if you decide to be honest with yourself and me, I'll be here. Just promise me this. What? Do try to deal with your bitterness with your father. Bitter hearts do not heal. She turns to him. You are my friend, and a good man. I do not wish to see the poison you're hiding consume you. Julian's eyebrows raise, the air goes tense. Don't think I haven't seen. The way you reacted to the spirits, the way you killed the cleric, the anger you show towards the gods every time you talk about them. There's a bitterness behind that, and with the way you talk about your father, I know where it comes from. Andri says, you are a remarkably good listener, and a remarkably terrible counselor. Julian says, but the gleam in his eyes tells her that she's right. You're a good man, Julian, a hero even, and I care for you. Andri tells him frankly, but I have seen too many good men turned foul by hatred to stand by while you face that same thing. I have a job to get done. Talking about my feelings or my relationship with my father is irrelevant. I will not afford distractions, he says, turning away. Not until it's done. Then we can sit and chat about it all you like. You have your oath, and I have mine. Andri says, think on it. You're not going to save the world standing on guard duty. She turns to head into her tent. Wake me if you need to talk. Is putting you in an enchanted sleep for the next several centuries an option? Julian jokes. You know it isn't. I'm afraid you're stuck with me and my irrelevant advice. Julian says as she leaves, and summons his cat to pet it. At least it's an irrelevancy from a good heart. The cat purrs. It's always the good hearts that are such a bother.